Thank you so much, Sabina. I would like to introduce you guys to Matrika, who is Muslim, experiencing psychosocial issues in the Philippines.
But it wasn't until 10 years later that he got psychosocial support. He is the first who dared to come out and introduce himself as a person who was experiencing psychosocial disability issues on national television. With the vision of mental health and psychosocial well-being for all, Mr. Devkota has been a chairperson for Koshish, which was established in 2008, and he worked extensively in advocacy as well as comprehensive recovery-based psychosocial support in Nepal. He has been acknowledged with the Dr. Guislain Breaking the Chains of Stigma Award in 2013. Whoa. And was elected as an Ashoka Fellow in 2017. In addition to this, he was awarded with the Social Service Award in 2013 and Human Rights Award by the National Human Rights Commission in December 2015. And due to its efforts in prioritizing mental health and psychosocial issues, Koshish has been awarded with the Best Social Organization in 2017. Introducing Mr. Matrika Devkota.
Good afternoon, honorable ladies and gentlemen, brother, sister. It's a great honor to be here. Likewise, I had never thought about working this issue, but something happened in old life, and that gave U-turn. Like my experiences, I feel like mental health issue, it's very diversity. It's person to person. And we respect the diversity. Like myself, from the age of 19, and roughly for 8 years, I was just in the home. It was difficult to be unwanted. And also, the professional service that I received, I recall in my memory, I went to clinician, and then I wasn't allowed to ask with the clinician. And the clinician would write medicines, would say, come after 3 months. And if I tried to ask medicine for what, how long, then he would be very mad, angry. I wouldn't have, courage to ask. Because there would be other hundreds of other people waiting for him, and he was the person making prescription. And, more hundreds of people waiting. And that was like that. It was in 1995 around. Then I struggled myself, and not like the expectation from the family and surrounding was, you had disease, now you got medicines, now 1 week, 2 weeks, oh, now already 2 weeks, you have to go back to work. And the thing is, I realized that the rehabilitation process and self-determination, what could I do at that time? I couldn't carry 50 kg. Then I had to start from 5 kg. So gradually, I realized that for the full recovery, that for the self-esteem, until I was able to work, I was able to feed myself, I was able to clothe myself, then I was able to help my parent. And then it took longer, and so I realized that mental health is beyond the health issue. Can be one part health, and not just like a killing bacteria, like antibiotic disease. And all of you, we know that, we realize that it is quite a holistic need, employment, housing, integration, and also in the community, people with mental health issue, Like one of the common things that everyone encountered is people would come say, "Are you recovered completely?" And people started looking at the animal in the zoo from head to head. People would watch, you know, for 2-3 minutes, and "Do you recognize me?" You know, the concept of people experience with this issue is penis. That's why, like, we realize that health, the component itself, is not enough. We need a comprehensive support, inclusion, that's meaningful inclusion in the community, on an equal basis as other. Then, I realize that, so our issue is either health issue or social welfare issue. I found myself in disability field as a looking as a holistic. Like a person from wheelchair without ramp can't come up or need to come through that way. And we don't look the person's impairment, but looking the barrier. Person with wheelchair, if no accessible, can't come up. It is infrastructure barrier. And not the person having the barrier, this is diversity. Likewise, people with mental health issues have to suffer more than medical issue. And stigma, stereotypes, and legally incompetence, and everything not treating as a human. So, I started coming in disability momentum and in Nepal. Nepal CRPD was ratified in 2010. And even it was quite harder to come to the disability momentum. Before CRPD, it was difficult. Like I and my group and were able to go to the craft disability and talking about our inclusion. And even craft disabilities also our recognition. And that was quite harder. And now we find everything in the Convention of the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. And especially like the now the challenges for the implementation of CRPD is and still in health system, they say, "How can you be disabled? Oh, you have whole bodies." And also disability momentum, like sometimes say, "Oh, I cannot see, but you can see the world." And, you know, some of the challenges for the social model and that address the barrier of the person with disability. Like, we person experience, live experience, and we, rather than problem having us, the problem is barrier. That's the social barrier, legal barrier, attitudinal barrier, every day, and me, my dear friend, my brother and sister, mother and father, people having this issue, suffering. Why not diabetes, hypertension? Not treated like that. They also have to also take medication or support medical help for long term. Why for mental health issue? And that's why is the barrier. Still we try to be, you know, like then support. Who am I? I'm not expert. I know what the pain is. I know what the way is. The problem is still the mindset is disease, thus we need to take that person, deprive from the community, and send to the hospital or institution, and the person can be feed there, and you know, that's penis. I'm lacking of thinking about, you know, what's the right to live and independently I'm being included in the community, like every human. How we can work against this stigma? The social barrier, legal barrier. I'm sorry, if I'm making quite bored after the launch, maybe If I'm speaking wrong, you can correct me. And I also like to have your question during the question at time. I would like to say that in spite of this barrier, and now we won't give up. We will not give up. Like in Nepal, like what we're doing is now we have gone to the Public Interest Litigation Supreme Court and taking the CRPD's right equal before the law, right to live independent, being included in the community. Nepal government has ratified CRPD optional protocol with a reservation. And according to the Nepali law, is international law is ratified, then domestic law should be dismissed naturally, but those are not. So we are going to Supreme Court and for the dismiss of such practices, such laws. And also we are going to communities rather than going with pills and you know like that. We time that people living in isolation, bringing them together. And I am not alone. Like my life, when I had this crisis, I used to blame I am the only one. And through the peer support, bringing people together and sharing the distress and the healing start from that, I would like to show one of the small pilot project of the peer support program, how that has been useful for the people. I'd like to request to play the video and look forward to interact more in question answer session. And also finally, I'm not here as an expert. I'm here as a lived experience. And what is the expert? And I don't know, like, and also in my life also, I would like to request to play the video, Kosis, Voice of Kosis. And even I had that situation, I tried to commit suicide. I was in coma for 72 hours, but that's the life, and no more from that vulnerabilities. Come up now, living for the cause, and living for the people, and as equal as basis, living independently, being included in the society, and will not give up. Okay, please watch. Please enjoy the video and have comment.
As a result, people with mental health issues are isolated, segregated, and live in vulnerable conditions.
Koshish is a disabled people's organization of Nepal established in 2008 by people who have experienced firsthand psychosocial disabilities. Koshish works to reduce stigma and discrimination because they compromise the quality of life of the affected persons and their families and represent major barriers in seeking services.
Koshish tried its best to bring together these isolated people, create a platform where they could share their pain and feelings in a confidential environment. As a result, they were able to raise their voices and explore resources for sustainability. We were able to have an evaluation of 29 people. Amongst these 29 beneficiaries, the self-esteem increased in the 23 benificiaries.
In the mind, there are various kinds of painful thoughts, and in this self-help group, we let it all out. If we just stay in the home, our mind gets worried and depressed. Therefore, when we come here and speak openly, we feel good, and even other members have shared this feeling. Earlier, I could not speak in front of others. There was no voice in my throat. Now the situation has changed, and I can speak with confidence. The self-help groups are necessary. Since we have the self-help groups, we are able to speak. Had there been no self-help group, where would we go to speak? Tell me.
The leadership skills improved in 6.
I have good experiences of the self-help groups. My peace of mind has improved. We exchange suggestions. I also give suggestions to my fellow group members.
And the self-confidence increased in 20 beneficiaries.
There was no talent in me to speak, but now I have the talent to speak in the self-help group meetings. These meetings have helped me immensely. I come to these meetings with the confidence that I can speak. I'm very happy.
The working efficiency increased in 20.
I work at the handicrafts. My uncle has export business to Japan. I go to help my uncle. I do agriculture and sell the vegetables. I have this work. It is nice.
And 15 beneficiaries had the support of family members.
My husband understands me and supports me completely. We share the work and do it together. He say or do nothing bad to me. There was problems. I was not allowed to speak with others. There was suspicion. Now the situation has improved greatly.
The 6 members self-advocated for their rights and 26 beneficiaries showed improvement in health.
Our past, our fundamental rights, what is psychosocial disability, how to speak in the society, everything is discussed at the self-help groups. We learned that we should not speak negative. We should only speak in positive terms. We should not be silent. When we listen to others, we know that it is not just me, and that other group members also have problems.
43 self-help group meetings were conducted in 2017, and the number was 105 in the year 2018. The main activities during self-help group meetings are active listening to each other and confidentiality, relaxation techniques, promoting life skills, meditation, physical exercise, yoga, music therapies, and discussion on the psychosocial issues. Personality development, depression, anger controlling, values of unity, self-help group, rights of people with disability, and so on. Developing and supporting and advocacy is the main motto of Voices for Coaches meeting. They have discussed and shared about the mental health problem, psychosocial disability, disability cards, and present disability movement. In addition, these self-help groups are also empowered and able to raise their voices with duty barriers. For example, they got involved in delegation to National Human Rights Commission, Health Ministry, and the Focal Ministry of Disability Women, Children, and Senior Citizens. Persons with mental health, psychosocial disability can also be functional. We request to hear and support them properly for the sustainability of self-help groups.
And we'll now start our Q&A session. Okay, the next question, we'll take the top one since it has the most likes. What can we do to help people who have poor insight that they have psychosocial disability? They tend to refuse help. I was going through this during the talks. I think that would go to you, Mr. Matrika.
Thank you. In my experience, the thing is, if someone stands there, going there, first time, and, you know, offering service would be difficult, but we meet these people so often and show our empathy, and, you know, not forcing them, but, you know, if whatever support they need, and this kind of empathetic attention with them also, that create trust and that help them, you know, if we are offering options, solution that is good for them and no one like that, but not we are opposing them giving someone with an option and, you know, like, it's need to have more empathetic relation to accept whatever, you know, to ask to facilitate in their solution.
The last question, how, Mr. Matrika, to break the barrier in the community so that they can accept those with mental illness?
Thank you. First of all, I'm being, we as a model, making the differences in the community, no matter what people think, it's important to have not to have selfish stigma among us. And other thing is also continue to inform them and not to give up awareness and people, you know, like ultimately and people understand. So for that, we need to be role model and like also our initiative should, you know, that transform the communities. And when people see the differences, and while only we speak, people won't believe, but they see the differences, then they will start to believe us.
Let's hope so. Thank you so much, Ms. Kavita, and also to Mr. Matrika for all of this wonderful information. For giving us fresh insights, ideas on how to social inclusion. Yeah.